Hello. I would love to be able to see each of you face to face today. However, as you're watching this video, I am on a journey of a lifetime. On this day, as you are watching this video, I am about right now returning to the hotel. I will have already ridden on the Sea of Galilee, walked in Capernaum, stood on the Mount of Beatitudes, and been baptized, rededicated in the Jordan River. I can't even begin to imagine as I sit here today how completely overwhelming that is going to be. I hope you're enjoying this study and that you're being blessed as we walk through these lessons. It's been a shift with new understanding. It's made me think about, once again, my kaleidoscope. I love how the teaching that this pastor once did for us at a retreat, a women's retreat, talked about a kaleidoscope, and we actually made them. This is not the one that I made, because the one I made was not nearly as beautiful as this. But she said that so often it is like God is pointing a kaleidoscope, and it's one click, and it changes the facets and the light that shines on his word, and we see new things. We see new colors. It adds new breath into his word. He is so faithful. One of my favorite things with this study so far has been from the very first week when she talked about progressive revelation. It is a gradual revealing of more and more information over time. How good of God not to dump the whole story on us at one time. My brain would just explode if he had done it that way. I really appreciate Tara-Leigh making the point that progressive revelation is revealing, but it is not corrective revelation. She goes on to say that when God reveals something new, he doesn't negate something that he previously revealed. He builds on and expands what he has already revealed to us. Progressive revelation can, however, change and correct what I have gotten wrong or what I have misunderstood. It can correct my thinking. And I got so tickled last week when Carissa used this verse, Romans 12:2. Let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Progressive revelation can also change what I do and what I say. One of my favorite chapters in Scripture comes from Colossians. It's chapter 3. And I love what it says here, that we are to put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On account of these things, the wrath of God is coming. In these two you once walked, when you were living in them, but now you must put them all away: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices. And I love the way the NLT puts verse 10. It's been one of my favorite verses for a long time, that we are to put on our new nature and be renewed as we learn to know our Creator and become like Him. In this week's lesson, we have been learning to know our Creator, God the Son. often called the second person of the Trinity. But we know that the order was progressively revealed: God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And there were three foundations that Tara-Leigh has made us write every week in our study, and I know that you can say them with me, so I'm going to ask when I get home, I'm going to ask Lee Angel and Carissa if you've said these with me. Our three foundations of the Trinity are: there is one God. There are three divine persons of the one true God. And the three persons are co-equal, co-eternal, and co-relational. God the Son. In John chapter 1, the first five verses, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Verse 4 says that life was in him, that he is life. John 14:6, Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." He is the life, and he came to give us life. But not just a run-of-the-mill, get-by-by-the-skin-of-your-teeth, drag-yourself-up-by-your-bootstraps kind of life. John 10:10, he tells us that the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but he came that we may have life and have it abundantly. In week one, we learned together that God created the world, and he created us out of the overflow of abundant love and happiness, out of joy. That he was, has, and is experiencing within himself. The biblical concept of abundance means exceedingly, very highly, beyond measure, more. A quantity so abundant as to be considerably more than what one would expect or anticipate. The Greek word is parousos, and it means superabundant in quality, but also superior in quality. Our abundant life is determined and defined by a relationship with God. In 2 Peter chapter 1, Peter writes, "His divine power has been granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature." We are to become partakers of the divine nature. As we learn to know our Creator, the abundant life is a continual process of learning, maturing, practicing, stepping out in faith. It's failure, it's recovering, it's enduring, it's adjusting, and it's overcoming. As we learn to know our Creator, it's not just to be head knowledge, not just to feel good. Its purpose is to lead to an outpouring of the abundance He has lavished on us. We are to become partakers of that divine nature. And that word partaker is a person who consumes or indulges in something. A person who joins in an activity or an action. I'm going to go on and read the next couple verses here in 2 Peter. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, and virtue with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with steadfastness, and steadfastness with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Virtue added to our faith. That's moral excellence, righteousness, goodness added to the faith that God has poured into us. Knowledge, we add that self-control because we've seen a lot of things in the world today where knowledge is just out of control. Unwavering in reflecting the nature of the kingdom of God. That's that steadfastness that we add godliness to. I love that. Unwavering in the reflecting of the nature of the kingdom of God in the course of your everyday life. We supplement godliness with brotherly affection and love for one's fellow man. It's brotherly kindness. We supplement that love to be effective and fruitful in our knowledge. That is the overflow. Love is the overflow. We are to love abundantly out of the overflow that God created us in. And Jesus, He set the bar high for us. In John 13, 34, Jesus says this, love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. That's a high bar. We are to love the way Jesus loves. We are to love the way Jesus loved us. We are to love with the purpose that Jesus came for, which was to love us abundantly and invite us into that abundant, overflowing relationship. What does that love look like? Well, 1 Corinthians 13, it tells us that it's patient, it's kind, it's not boastful, it's not proud, and it's not envious. Romans 12, 9 says that our love is to be genuine. And in Colossians, back to that chapter 3, it tells us that we are to put on as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Love. We've talked about it a lot. The world talks about it a lot. We love a lot of different things, but this is a different kind of love. This is a love that wants the very best. I was so excited when I heard Carissa last week talk about that love was filled with a desire for each one to enjoy the relationship, to enjoy the fruit, to enjoy the joy and the love within the Trinity. In 1 John 4, 10 and 11, it says, "This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us. And he sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sin." Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. God is a God of overflowing abundance. He desires for us to live a life overflowing with his character. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. If God didn't do one other thing for us, this eternal life, life with him for all eternity, is the complete definition of abundant life. Living for all eternity in the overflow of his love. I'm going to close us out with a prayer from St. Richard's. And it goes like this. Thanks be to you, our Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits which you have given us, for all the pains and insults which you have borne for us. Most merciful Redeemer, friend, brother, may we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly day by day. Amen.